Okay, so recently OpenAI introduced their update to using JSON schemas and function calling, et cetera, and they're calling this structured outputs in the API. So in many ways, this is not hugely new. We've already had function calling. We've already had the ability to do a lot of this stuff. What they have changed in here, though, is now they're guaranteeing a JSON response back. So in the past, you would have to use tools like LangChain, like Instructor, to do multiple calls until you actually got the call that had JSON in it. Now, the models themselves have been getting better and better over time. If you look back, even from OpenAI's own examples, if we look back at the early GPT-4 models, from prompting alone, they didn't give back JSON. With the early versions of JSON mode, they gave back JSON quite well, but they still did fail about 10% of the time. So you had tools like Instructor, where you would basically get it just to recall the model and perhaps point out where the model had done wrong in this. Now, those libraries like Instructor are still very useful for other models out there. And as the open weights models have gotten better, people are still trying to basically get this sort of consistent JSON out. Now, one of the things that people have used in the past is Jsonformer, which I've talked about here, which uses a number of different tricks. Now, we could imagine that OpenAI is using some things like this, although my guess is that they've had to substantially tweak this to get it to work with their inference system. But the cool thing is, now they're guaranteeing that you will get a JSON result back that follows your schema 100% of the time. Now, it's very important to understand that doesn't mean that you're going to get the perfect answer back each time. And I will go through and work through some code with this and point that out in code. But the cool thing is you are going to get a response back in the JSON that you define. So they've got two main ways of using this. They've updated function calling to support this. And then they've also got this way of where you can basically just pass in a data model and get the results back for that. So that's what I want to look at in this video. When you're building agents, one of the key things that you want to do is to be able to extract data out that you're going to use for a particular purpose. So often that can be as simple as just reading an article and basically pulling out data from that article that you want to file away somewhere, you want to use it for a response, a whole bunch of different things like that. So they've updated their native SDK now to basically support Pydantic or Zod objects straight out. So Pydantic is the one that we're going to use for Python. This is basically how we can make our data models, how we can pass these things around. And then Zod is basically the JavaScript equivalent of that. So if you're using something with JavaScript, you could basically use Zod for that. In this example, I'm going to go with Pydantic here. So the example that I want to show you is an example that actually we tried to build about 4 or 5 years ago, was that to get something that could pass a whole bunch of different articles and pull out certain kinds of data to build knowledge graphs from. And at the time, our startup partnered with an academic institution. We had a number of different students working on this for probably close on 4 months, 5 months. And to be honest, the results were okay, but not great. And certainly nothing like where we've gotten to now with using large language models for doing this. So what I want to do is I want to basically go through, and in this particular example, we're going to basically pass out people's names, product names, organizations, a few kind of things like that. Now, normally you would want to use a NER system or a named entity recognition system for that. And that is a reasonably solved thing for things like people's names. Where it starts to fall apart often is things related to products or getting it to identify more unusual classes. So I'll talk about that as we go through. So here you can see I'm just basically bringing in OpenAI key. Because we're going to be using Pydantic, we're going to basically inherit from the Pydantic base model for everything. And I've just got a simple function here that can basically get an article back so that we could scrape an article, for example, pull that down. And you can see that, sure enough, if I pass in this article from TechCrunch, we can basically get the text back from that. And that's what we're going to pass into the OpenAI model. Okay, now the key thing in setting up something like this is we want to set up the pedantic models for this. So this is our data models. Eventually, what we're going to do is we want a sort of article response that's going to be returned back. And that's going to have a list of products that it found in there. It's going to have a list of people. It's going to have a list of organizations that it found in there. And it's going to have a summary of the article. So we're trying to do all of this with just one call going in here. Now, to do this, we have to basically define what a product, what a person, what an organization is. So you can see here, if we look at the product, we've got a product is going to have a name, it's going to belong to an organization, and it's going to have a product type. So here you can see we've got a description that's being passed in there. If we look at the product type up here, we can see that, okay, for the sake of this, I'm going to basically say, okay, the product type can be a device, can be an app, can be fintech, it can be SaaS, it could be consumer tech. Now, I'm defining these. So the reason why you want to do this, and this is using enums here, the reason why you're doing this is you don't want the model just making up names. So you'll see that, for example, if we're going to pass this article about the new Google Pixel phones, we don't want it just sometimes saying smartphone, sometimes saying device, sometimes saying handheld device, something like that. So we want to constrain it. And this is a key factor when you're building any sort of agent now. You want to constrain how you're using the language model to basically constrain the outputs that you can then filter on, you can then use for different things. So you could imagine once I constrain these, I can then put these into a database. I can then do a search for anything that's a device, anything that's an app, that kind of thing. And you'll see that I do that for a few different things. So for product type, I've got these ones. For organization type, I've got startup, big tech, tech media, social media, government, venture capital, etc. This is where this sort of way of doing it can be better than a simple NERM model, in that you're leveraging the knowledge of the large language model to know that sort of Google is big tech, right? And that perhaps certain media organizations are going to be tech media, and certain organizations are going to be venture capital as opposed to a startup, that kind of thing. So we set up those enums to be choices for things like the product type, the organization type, etc. And you can see that I'm setting up quite a number of these. So I've got that. I've got person, which is going to be name, organization, role. I've got product, which is name, organization, product type, which we defined above there. Organization with organization type that we've defined. And then finally, we're coming out with this article response. So this is the only one that we're going to pass into the OpenAI call. But this one requires all these others to be set. So it's helping it to basically fill out all those details in there. All right, so the actual OpenAI call is pretty simple. We're just using the Python SDK in here. So you can see that they've got a passing completions thing here. So I'm just going to tell it you're a helpful assistant that scans for people, products, and organizations mentioned in articles. And then we're going to pass in the response format is this model format for article response that we've got there. We can now basically just run it through, and I'm passing in the article, which I got up here when we got the article content. And we can see that sure enough, when we basically run this through, it gives us back a list of each of these things. So we got a list of names, which actually is only one name. So this is got the name and an organization. I've gone through and actually passed out and printed each product. So we can see we've got a Pixel 9, organization Google, product type device. So we can see that we've got there. Pixel 9 Pro, again, Google device. Pixel 9 Pro Fold, again, device. And then Pixel Studio, which is an app that they featured. Call Notes, which is an app. Pixel Screenshots, which is an app. And then organization, we've got Google. The org type is big tech. Location, Mountain View, California. Now, I don't think Mountain View, California was in the article, right? So we're leveraging the sort of knowledge of the large language model in that way for this. And then we can see we've got a summary of the article out. Google's annual Made by Google hardware event unveiled several AI-related features exclusive to the Pixel 9 family of devices. So you can see we've got all of that sort of covered in here. Now, what we could do, and I didn't end up doing this, but we could actually just pass this out and pass these to a list. And you could imagine that going to a database, going to something else. What I've done now is basically just package this into a function in here so we can run a few different things through it. And you can see, sure enough, I've passed in a different article this time, but about the same topic, the Pixel 9 event. And you can see, sure enough, it's picked out that, okay, the first person it's got is Chris Welch, which is from The Verge, a photographer. And then we've got Victoria Song, also a photographer. So it seems like they used basically some pictures, which they then gave credit for. We can see we've got the devices, the new phones there mentioned. We've got the apps, Pixel Studio, Pixel Screenshots. And then we've got more devices of the watch and the new earbuds and stuff being mentioned. Okay, so we can see we've got the organization there, Google, Big Tech. And we can see we've got The Verge and that tech media location, New York. I'm not sure if that's true or not in there. And then we've got our summary there. All right, what if I take some other articles, just random stuff? Okay, an article about Jeff Bezos, Amazon. We've got the different people in there being the Jeff Bezos, Amazon CEO and founder. We've got a reporter. We've got, you know, organizations and stuff like that. It's going, so far it's getting it all right. Now, I will say that it's not perfect. You will find that with some of these, as particular this first article, this article is not about the phones themselves. It's about more about the AI apps and stuff that were released around them. So occasionally it just mentions the Pixel family of phones and not in the individual actual phones in there when it returns back. So you do want to test it, and you should realize that the 100% just means you're going to get JSON schema back, not you're going to get accurate details in that JSON schema back. And then finally, I put in another article about a fintech startup which is shutting down. You see, sure enough, it was able to work out that this is the organization, the person, and we can see we've got the organization finding startup in here, location San Francisco. And we can see we've also got all these different VCs, Sway Ventures, VC. Location doesn't know. Andreessen Horowitz, venture capital. Location doesn't know. Kleiner Perkins, VC. So you can see that it's able to work out most of these, and then TechCrunch, tech media in there. So it's done a good job at building a parser. Now, so at this stage, we would have a number of different options depending on what we're going to be using this for. We could just run this through and keep a bunch of the data that we're actually using to then fine tune a NER model, something like a BERT model or something like a distilled BERT, which would be quite quick at this task and certainly a lot cheaper to run than a large language model for this kind of task. Or we could do something where we're going to be using this data on the fly, an agent, combining it with other data. You could imagine that you could build a very good agent that would just go through every article on TechCrunch each day. Now, I could have added to this where we could have had a crawler to get all today's articles, gone through each of them and seen, okay, was our startup mentioned in these articles at all? Or was this company mentioned? And companies pay a lot of money for that kind of service to see, okay, what articles they were mentioned in. And then we could have also had, just we had summary here, we could have also basically had it do a sentiment analysis for each of the products that are mentioned, that kind of thing. So you've got a whole bunch of different use cases that you can use this kind of thing for in agents. And it really comes down to how creatively you set up these data models in here. So while everyone's focused on function calling as being the really cool thing and stuff like that, it is a very cool thing. And I've covered it in multiple videos and stuff like that. One of the big things that people overlook is this ability to pass out the right information and to get the model to do multiple tasks at the same time, in that we're basically getting it here to extract our products, people, organizations, and write a summary about the article. So you could imagine we could add to this that it could do a sentiment, we could add in a whole bunch of different tasks and then be able to use that for writing a report or for doing something else later on. So I just wanted to show you a different take on the idea of the structured outputs and of how you can actually use this kind of thing to make your agents better and to stop your agents going off the rails. So with the whole idea of using the enums is to constrain the outputs so that you're getting something that you can then pass into some kind of programmatic use that could be a checker, could be a whole bunch of different things. So I'll probably show some more examples of this in some of the new agent videos that I've been making and show how people are using this kind of thing for doing code rewriting and creating unit tests for that code as it's actually writing the code. So another cool thing that I haven't mentioned about this model that they've released is that it's a lot cheaper. So they've basically reduced the cost by 50% on inputs and 33% on outputs. So this definitely makes the GPT-4o model now a lot cheaper. There are a couple of things you may want to be careful about. So they've got some limitations and restrictions in here. The one that I thought was kind of interesting is that the JSON schemas that you supply, even though you're using them through the API, they're not covered under the zero data retention thing. So you could imagine that maybe these are going to be used for training. So if you do have anything really restrictive in that, you might want to think about that before you start using this. Anyway, as always, if you've got any comments or questions, please put them in the comments below. If you found the video useful, please click like and subscribe. I will talk to you in the next video. Bye for now.